This evening on the Rock Newman Show, there are 1.5 million Americans serving in the U.S. Armed Forces and 22 million veterans. When active duty is all you know, leaving the military may seem daunting. Mark London of the Warrior Scholar Project and two veterans join us to discuss the trials and triumphs of transitioning to civilian life. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. To celebrate Veterans Day, we are taking an in-depth look at the program that serves those who served our country. The Warrior Scholar Project offers veterans a free two-week academic boot camp designed to help prepare them for the rigors of higher education. We are joined by board member Mark London and two program graduates, James Fitzgerald and Mark Henderson. Thank you so much for being here. Veterans Day, I just can't think of a better time to have you guys. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having us, Rock.
Mark London, I've known you for a long time. You have been doing documentaries. You've been involved in veteran affairs of some sort for some 20 plus years. I mentioned you've done a documentary on the Warrior Scholar Project, and we want to get into that. Not only have you been doing work with Veteran Affairs for quite some time, you also, when it comes to talking about documentaries, and we have a little footage from one of your documentaries from Brazil. You were in the Amazon, as you did a documentary called A Shark Loves the Amazon. I bring that up at the outset because one of the debates raging in our country now, and it affects everybody, veterans, as to whether or not we might even have any more wars, is the issue of climate change. And your time in Brazil, studying the Amazon amongst the people and everything else, when I hear people talk about climate change, the Amazon is often referred to. Why?
The Amazon rock is the motor that is in the engine of climate in the world. About 20% of the greenhouse gas emissions that come out and mess up the climate, about 40% of that comes from the Amazon. 20% comes from rainforests, and 40% of that comes from the Amazon. So you're talking about 8% of greenhouse gas emissions comes from the Amazon. There was a warming trend in the Amazon in 2005, and you'd see drought in the Amazon, and through that warming trend, you saw Katrina in New Orleans. So it's an engine that affects our climate up here, certainly affects the climate in Brazil. And one of the reasons that a lot of the agricultural interests have embraced climate change over time is they've realized that if they mess up the climate, they'll mess up their crops and their cattle and everything else. So it's a subject that affects people from the left, the right, the rich, the poor, and everybody else. And the Amazon is a crucial part of it.
And again, I want to just one more thing here. We definitely want to get to this Warrior Scholar Project. When we talk about the Amazon and when we talk about climate change, is it your sense that you have some people, typically on the left, who are at war with the right, or vice versa, that one claims it's a bunch of hocus pocus and the other side talks about the potential doom and gloom? How should we feel about it?
Well, you should feel that this is a significant problem. And if you go to the Amazon and you see how rainforest has become desert, and rainforest has become basically a parking lot, you'll see what will happen if you mess around with the climate. You mess around with biodiversity, you mess around with rainfall patterns, and you mess around, therefore, with the habitat of all types of animals, including human beings. And it's catastrophic if this continues.
Okay. I repeat, it is Veterans Day, and we're celebrating. It doesn't matter where the viewer tonight might line up in terms of feeling as if there shouldn't be a military. You know, people who sign up to go to war are betraying God, if you will, or those who don't sign up to go into the military are betraying their country. It doesn't matter if you are a hawk or a dove. These young men who are here with you today represent those who, no matter what you feel politically, they go and put their lives on the line. So we're here to celebrate you tonight. And again, we thank you for being here. Let's start as sort of at the beginning here. Warrior Scholar Project. What's that all about?
Okay, if you could, look. You said at the outset that we go back a long way, like 30 years, and I have all these lives that you have that I don't know about, my lives that you don't know about. Yeah. So let me tell you about what I've been doing for about 20 years and how it leads into this.
Yes.
So about 20 years ago, Rock, I got involved with a bunch of people who had the notion that we needed to take care of the people who went and served for us. Mm-hmm. This is a time, this is before thank you for your service, this is before, you know, there were golf outings for veterans or anything like that. These are folks who recognized that we had done wrong to our Vietnam veterans. These were not politicians who went out over to fight Vietnam. These were soldiers, men and women, and they were doing their duty, and we turned our backs on them.
Yeah.
So about 20 years ago, I got involved in an organization called the Special Operations Fund, very much under the radar. We didn't do auctions. We didn't do anything. We just went out. We got a bunch of folks who cared about this, and we sent about 300 widows and kids of dads who had been killed to college. After 9/11 came along, the country woke up and realized that there needs to be some type of public and private partnership to help these veterans. This is before the GI Bill, and after 9/11, there was very little government support. But these organizations began to flourish. And over time, certainly in the special operations field, there's a lot of support for the men and women who go and fight. About 3 years ago or so, my organization, as I say, is very quiet. Mm-hmm. But in that community, people would come to me and they'd have ideas. You know, we'd like to start this organization. We'd like to start another one. And we gave a lot of support. We gave money. We supported the Injured Marine Semper Fi Fund. We supported scholarship funds at Delta, at the Navy SEALs. We've done a lot of that support. And then this organization came along, the Warrior Scholar Project. The idea is, look, let's deal with enlisted men and women. Men and women who never really wanted to go to school. That's why they enlisted at 17 and 18.
Sure.
They had a sense of duty to their country, or they had a sense that I needed to do something to better my life, and they went and they fought. Mm-hmm. We needed them to have an opportunity once they came back to build on the experiences that they had, build on the educations that they had through life, and help them. And so there are these two folks who were at Yale, Jesse Rising and Chris Howell. They came up with this idea, let's have a boot camp. And they got Yale to sponsor this. And at Yale, it's 2 weeks. It's intensive boot camp for men and women who have gone into the service, and now they want to go into higher education. Mm-hmm. And what it does, Rock, is it helps these men and women understand the potential that they have. It makes them realize that they are capable of basically, I hate to use the Army slogan, be all that they can be, and they are. Mm-hmm. You see these, now they're grown-ups.
Yeah.
They have life experiences. They have maturity. They have leadership. They have courage. And we help them get the tools so that they are comfortable learning. And they can be stars in the classroom. And if they're stars in the classroom, they then educate their fellow students. And they come out, and they become stars in the community. And this is better for them. But I'll tell you, it's better for all of us. I mean, society as a whole is better for helping the people who deserve the support that they should get.
Let's go to the stars at this table here. Mark Henderson.
Yes, sir.
Tell us, if you would, please, as a veteran, what went into your decision-making process to enlist?
Well, first, I just want to say thank you for being here. It's really an honor to be here today, and especially sitting next to somebody here who's a genuine hero, and I feel humbled and honored, especially because I did not do service in the same way that this gentleman did, which I'm excited for him to tell his story as well. But I was a 17-year-old kid and a junior in high school. Just like Mr. London just mentioned, I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do with my life, didn't have an interest in going to college at the time, and I decided that the best thing I could do at that time was set myself up for my future for when I was ready and when I did know what I wanted to do. And I did have that sense of duty, a sense of calling, and a strong desire to be a part of something bigger than myself. Mm-hmm. I graduated high school after my junior year. I want to say I finished in August. I was in the Army by September of 2008. And it was one of the most difficult things I ever did. I was challenged every day, but it was also one of the best things I ever did. Yes, sir.
One of the most difficult things you ever did, you were challenged every day. Give us some examples.
So first off, really just that sense of culture shock. You're in this environment where, definitely an environment of intimidation from the very beginning. It's, again, 17 years old,
yeah.
You know, no life experience outside of my small towns that I'd grown up in.
Right.
You're getting woken up at 4 a.m. every day. You're screaming. And something I learned quickly in the military was, every objective that you're given is an impossible objective. You're given something with an amount of time where you cannot accomplish that task with that amount of time, and you just have to roll with it every day. Do your best, and you learn how to work as a team. Mm-hmm. And that was all kind of new things when you're in an environment like I grew up in. Then all of a sudden you're around these people from all different walks of life. It was very eye opening, but the physical challenges, the emotional challenges of being cut off from your family. You know, not speaking to people back home, and really just learning how to rely on yourself. You know, there's always that narrative of they try to break you down to build you back up. That's a challenge for a 17-year-old kid.
And you did boot camp where?
I went to Fort Sill in Oklahoma.
Uh-huh. While you were there going through those challenges as a 17, 18-year-old young buck, did it ever cross your mind, this is not worth it?
I would say night one, I had that moment where I'll never forget. I laid down in the bunk. I want to say we showed up around 3 o'clock in the morning, and you know, knowing we're going to be up in about 2 hours maybe. And I was just laid, and I looked up in the bunk above me, and I thought, what did I just get myself into?
Yeah.
So there were certainly those times when you're thinking, you know, kind of questioning what you did. But at the same time, as you challenge yourself and as you really push yourself and accomplish things that you didn't even know you were capable of, you realize this is exactly where I'm supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hard, of course, but nothing that's good is easy.
Was there one particular drill sergeant that you hated the most that you ended up knowing that person had a great impact on your life?
There was a drill sergeant, Drill Sergeant Murphy, and he was kind of notorious in our battalion. Everybody called him Murph, but never to his face. And he was very tough, but at the same time, you just felt like you would follow that man into hell because you knew he had your back. And every time he pushed you or he challenged you, he was teaching you a lesson, and he was teaching you, you know, how to rely on yourself and rely on each other. So just like you said, it came around to the point where you realize this is happening for a reason, and you learn to respect those people. There's no animosity. You realize that, you know, they're there to teach you who you're supposed to be.
James Fitzgerald, you grew up where?
Columbia, Tennessee.
Okay. And tell us about your decision-making process where you stepped across that line.
I joined the Army when I was 19. I was at a point in my life to where I really wasn't sure the path that I needed to walk in order to achieve the goals that I had set for myself.
Mm.
I'd made the decision to join the Army knowing that, number one, I love being an American. I love our country.
Mm.
I love the world that I grew up in. I always felt the need to give back. I always felt the need to serve. I felt that was the best way for me to, you know, absorb more of the world that I want to be a part of.
Mm-hmm.
Joining the United States Army, being a part of the infantry, being a part of combat arms, one of the greatest fighting forces, you know, ever, you know, walking this earth.
Mm-hmm.
It was a surreal experience for a 19-year-old kid coming from Tennessee. I joined for, you know, my first enlistment for 3 years, thinking I'm going to go in, going to do the Army thing, get out, go to school.
Yeah.
I join, and just as Mark said, you get this giant shock once you're actually part of the big green machine. You meet these individuals that, you know, you never in your wildest dreams thought would be your friends or be that guy that you would call on in the middle of the night when you have something going on.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what I got. Every single day, I gained more of a connection to the world that I wanted. That's what kept me in for, you know, almost a decade in the United States Army.
And so in that in that boot camp process, were there moments when you questioned as to whether or not you had made the right decision?
Absolutely. Every hour on the hour, and then sometimes in my sleep, I would dream about talking to myself saying, what were you doing? But at the same time, I could never follow that thought up with, you should quit,
mm-hmm.
or you should stop,
mm-hmm.
or let's see how we can get out of this situation, because I was excited to see what the next moment was going to bring, because mm-hmm. The one thing about the military that I can say is they keep you on your toes.
Mm-hmm.
There's never a dull moment. I was just given an opportunity to do things that no one else in this world is, you know, given the opportunity to do.
What happened during boot camp that you were able to overcome that you never imagined that you might be able to do what it was that you overcame?
And this is going to be a shock to people that know me now, but actually vocalizing my thoughts and connecting with other people and letting them know my worth and letting them know.
Why are both of you guys stifling a laugh?
I've been holding them prisoner, talking to them for days. So this is their first break. But that was the biggest challenge for me.
And how did that come about?
You're forced to do that. I mean, during boot camp, the first thing that they do is break you down physically, but they're building you up mentally, physically, emotionally. They're preparing you for what's coming forth.
My viewers out there who might be having the same question I have, I want, you know, both of you to talk a little bit about what that means, because you hear it all the time. And it seems as if people never follow up. They break you down physically and build you up mentally. It seems like a conflict. What do they do? What's the process that allows that to happen?
The methodology behind breaking down physically is to let you know that you're going to be continuously given tasks, just as Mark was describing, that seem impossible. You're going to do the task to the best of your physical ability, but you're going to continuously fail or come up short.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of like that being the end of the story, no, they're letting you know that tomorrow you're going to do it again.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't finish, you're still going to get that much closer. Mm-hmm. And it's that continual drive.
So in other words, it might be, give me 100 push-ups and somebody might be able to do 48 push-ups. Well, tomorrow you got to do another 100, and then perhaps you get up to 58.
I can give you the perfect example of that. My first physical fitness test in boot camp, you know, they bring you down and you do push-ups, sit-ups, and a 2-mile run.
Mm-hmm.
My first PT test, I did 3 push-ups. I did 6 sit-ups, and I didn't complete my 2-mile run.
You were one of those 98-pound weaklings.
I was. Uh-huh. And I was right next to a guy that was a 168-pound weakling, so we had a lot to talk about.
Uh-huh.
But it was that guy that helped, you know, push me through to let me know that when I wake up in the morning that I can accomplish my goals.
Right.
And if I can't, he's going to be behind me supporting me.
Mm-hmm.
And I continuously got that same feeling from every single day in the military, that if I feel like I can't do it, I know I can turn to my left and my right or my front and my back, and I'll find someone that will let me know that I can do it.
Yeah.
And if I could piggyback on that, that's exactly right. And it's not only that, is I feel like the breaking you physically to build you up mentally is to teach you that you are capable of things that you had no idea you were capable of. You know, you can be running around somewhere, you know, all around the base at, you know, 0:30 in the morning and thinking you just can't take another step. And there's somebody behind you saying, are you going to quit because it hurts? And the answer is always no. It's one of our Army values. I will never quit. And you just continue to push yourself until you realize I can do these things. And I think that's where that mental strength comes from. Of, you know, I didn't know my body could go that far, but, you know, my mind, it's mind over matter, and that's really something they instill in you.
Mark, a little research here lets us know that you spent time in one of the poorest regions of the world. You spent time in Haiti.
Yes, sir.
What was it in Haiti where you had to call on some of the training that you got in boot camp and, you know, some of what you learned through your military experience?
Well, Haiti was such a different mission for us from things that we learned in boot camp. But again, the mental toughness, because when we got to Haiti, I mean, it was days after the devastating earthquake in January of 2010. Yeah. And we were really living amongst the Haitians. I know we slept the first night, maybe two nights I was there in an airfield where we landed there in Port-au-Prince. And then we actually stayed, I want to say, at a horse compound from somebody. And I know that myself and a few others, we slept 59 days outside with our poncho strung up above us for protection from the rain. And again, it wasn't necessarily military tactics that we leaned on in Haiti, because the mission was so different. It was humanitarian. Mm-hmm. But leaning on each other and knowing that we're going to get through it together. And that's something I really, you know, people always say you're going to miss the military when you get out. And when you're in it, you think, I don't know about that.
Yeah.
But you really miss having those brothers that you know it's not where you are, it's who you're with. And every situation is better because you're in that situation with people that you trust and people that you love.
Okay, so, you know, one of the reasons that I love doing this show is because we have a variety of experiences that I think we are able to show our viewers a whole nother lens through which to view life. So, you're in Haiti. Just a few days after the incredible earthquake, where there are hundreds of thousands of lives lost, and you sleep outside for 59 nights. Now, inevitably, I'm going to assume, which perhaps we should never do, but that you saw death all around you.
Yes, sir. There were certainly times. And I will say the heroes to me of the mission in Haiti were the medics that I saw. I saw so much. I mean, they just became, I mean, these great examples of what people join the military to do. And they came back with stories that were just heart-wrenching. And so for me personally, of course, you know, we saw it driving around because at the beginning, you know, it was more of a search and rescue mission that people were kind of, you know, conducting. And at the time, I was fortunate to be working as the assistant and the driver to the command sergeant major of our battalion, Command Sergeant Major Wilbur Myatt. So we did a lot of driving around Haiti. Mm-hmm. And yes, certainly driving around and seeing what the troops in different locations were doing throughout the region, it was mass devastation, and it was difficult to witness. I remember I looked at him one day and I said, you know, and again, I'm 18, 19 years old at the time. I'm very fresh, and only time I spent out of the country was on a cruise. So this, to me, you know, you can imagine. Yeah. And I said, you know these places exist, you hear about them, but until you see it, until you're there, until you're looking at it, you really can't imagine. And it was a life-changing experience for me.
And I could spend hours talking to each of you. I want to stay with you just for a moment. Experiencing what you experienced there in Haiti, the devastation, you know, the utter poverty. What thoughts did you have, if any, about people who might be in your circle, in your family, or whatever, knowing that we are a privileged society here? You're seeing what you saw there. Did you ever have a sense of, if I get back home and I hear anybody complain about anything, I'm gonna slap them?
Every day. Thought that every day. And that's what amazed me so much about the Haitian people as well, was that in the midst of that devastation, they don't feel sorry for themselves. They're out there working to rebuild, you know, what they had, and they're driving on every day, just as we were taught to do. And it was inspiring. And of course, you have those feelings, and you lie to yourself and you say, when I get back to the States, you know, I'm never going to complain about 8 a.m. or 9 a.m. classes. It's not true. We still complain about 8 a.m. 9 a.m. classes. Yeah. But absolutely. And you just kind of realize in that moment, our problems are not real problems. And it does, you know, kind of build a bit of frustration when you see the, you know, some of the things that we concern ourselves with, and you think back and you look at what people are really, you know, what true suffering looks like.
Mark, maybe a 5-minute walk from here is one of the hospital, Veterans Affairs Hospital. And you could probably walk in that hospital and write a horror story about people who go and put their lives on the line and come back and don't get treated, they get mistreated. You've been as you said, 20 plus years. Here's an opportunity, I'm sure, a guy sitting down at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, Barack Hussein Obama, watches the Rock Newman show. What do you say to Obama and his staff and everybody else about how to treat veterans better?
Well, Rock, I'm gonna play tennis. I'm gonna bat that back for a minute and then hit it over to the side to James, because we, rather than my talking about what I think, mm-hmm. let's have James talk about what he experienced, because he had this care. Okay. But let's talk about that. But before we get there, I just want to, I'm sitting here, nobody's lifted a gun yet.
Yeah.
You know, we're talking about the military.
Yeah.
And, you know, one of the things that strikes me whenever I talk to the veterans is that we have missed out in our society, those of us who haven't served, on this incredibly democratizing process that they all have. Mm-hmm. They all, white, black, Muslim, Jewish, Catholic, they're all thrown in this place together, mm-hmm. men, women. Mm-hmm. And you've heard them before, they have each other's backs.
Oftentimes, these sects, whatever they might be, with all of their differences, there's a commonality, they go to hell.
You got that right.
Yeah.
And it creates a bond among them, which carries out into our society, and we're losing that. I'm not advocating that everybody go into the military, but I'm advocating that everybody appreciate the social aspects of what they've gone through. Mm-hmm. Not only their heroism, their courage, but their ability to break down all the barriers from a rural Tennessee existence to an urban existence. Mm-hmm. I mean, they become friends,
mm-hmm.
you know, and we're missing that. We have all this divisiveness in this country. There's no divisiveness over here. I mean, these guys are friends. They have, you know, the brotherhood or the sisterhood. I mean, when I go to the Warrior Scholar Project sessions throughout the summer, that's what I hear all the time. We have each other's backs. Mm-hmm. So I just want to point that out. But let's talk about James and James's treatment. And if you really want to hear heroism, let's hear it.
You know what? That's a nice punt.
Okay.
You said tennis, but it's a nice punt. That's okay. But before we talk about your treatment after the time that you served, I am going to take the liberty to try to maybe even impose and to go deep into your story. Because, again, I think of our viewers out there, and certainly myself, I don't know what it's like to be shot at. And I would say, you know, 99.9%.
Wait, hold on a second. I sat at the old convention center with you, Rock, okay? Anybody goes on the video, okay? I was sitting right next to you when you went in for Elijah Hill artillery, okay? You got punched, okay? Not shot at.
So those watching perhaps don't understand what it feels like being shot at, let alone getting shot. So I'd like for you, served in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Yes, sir.
Tell us about sort of the most seminal moments in that service.
I'll preface everything about my deployment time with this. A lot of people say that I could never do that, or I don't know what I would do in that position.
Mm-hmm.
Given the situation of someone shooting at you or pointing a weapon at you, it's pretty clear what the majority of people would do. You get put in a situation, you're going to react in your survival sense. No different, that's when I don't consider myself a hero. I did what, you know, the majority of people would do in a reasonable situation. For me, deploying, it was a forethought in the back of my mind of the general thought of I'm putting my life on the line for the country and I could not make it back. Those were thoughts far in the back of my mind.
Mm-hmm.
I was there with my brothers and my sisters. I was there doing a job that I enjoyed for the country.
And your job was what?
I was in the infantry.
Mm-hmm.
I made it to the rank of staff sergeant. I was a squad leader, an instructor, held various positions, and I enjoyed each and every one of them. When you lead soldiers, it's a sense of responsibility and a sense of duty that I can't think off the top of my head another profession that you get that kind of commitment. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe a police officer or a firefighter, but, mm-hmm. you know, on large scales when you're deploying to different countries trying to serve a sense of justice and a sense of democracy. Mm-hmm. And then you're doing it with the men that you trained. Mm-hmm. I don't have a wife or kids. Right. My soldiers were my family. Right. So when I would deploy, it's like taking my kids to a different country to do a job with their father. Mm-hmm. Bring your kids to work day, mm-hmm. except they work for you. So during those deployments, you spend a year with these men and women, and you do nothing but talk about your lives. So you gain that connection. Mm-hmm. And that's what, you know, we speak about when we say we do the things for the left, or the guy or girl on our left and right, because mm-hmm. these people know everything about you, and mm-hmm. you know everything about them. Mm-hmm. And when you have that connection, it will force you and compel you to do things you normally wouldn't do.
Give us a good example of being in the field with those guys.
The day I was injured, the mission, I was part of 101st Airborne, 1327. And the mission kicked off on Veterans Day of 2010. And, you know, very dangerous mission, going to remove some training camps from an area in Kandahar. And we had already known that the mission was gonna be rocky. Mm-hmm. So as I tell my soldiers that, you know, hey, you know, strap in, it's gonna be a rough ride. And we get on the ground and they actually see it for themselves. You, as a leader, have to look at those men, even though you're scared, you know, to your core, mm-hmm. you still have to look at those men and say, we have a job to do, mm-hmm. we're gonna do it, and we have to make it through. There's no time to be, you know, scared. There's no
What was your job that day, and what were the obstacles?
I was a squad leader. I had 8 soldiers under me. The job that day that I was injured, we were moving towards this, you know, specific house that had some high value targets in it. Mm-hmm. And my element
and
was
just
in
to
the
be
lead.
Clear. High value targets are somebody from Al Qaeda or
yes, sir.
Somebody's fighting against you. These are
absolutely.
These are human beings.
The bad guys.
The bad guys. Okay.
And so, my element's in the lead, and the obstacles that day was trying to navigate the difficult terrain of Afghanistan. I will take a quick pause to say the country of Afghanistan is underrated in its beauty. I spent months and months and months just being awed by the beauty of that country. Mm-hmm. I would have had a vacation home there had there not been so many people trying to kill me. But, you know,
Right now, you're going after the bad guy.
Yes, sir. Okay. And so we're traversing this terrain, and we're trying to navigate as best as we can. Mm-hmm. And we had gotten ambushed at a pivotal point in our transition. You know, we couldn't move left. Humongous draw, so we couldn't get to that. We could have moved right, but it was a complete open area. Can't move back because all our guys are behind us. Mm-hmm. So when they attacked us, it was a perfect, you know, ambush. And I'm having to still lead my men, even though I'm in my mind thinking to myself, this is the day that I will not make it back. This is the day that, you know, mm-hmm. is gonna end it.
You come face to face with death.
But at the same time, I have a great sense of humor, so I'm gonna go out with a laugh. Mm-hmm. So as we're doing our job, you know, reacting to this ambush, you know, I'm talking to my second in command, trying to figure out what to do. And, you know, he's my best friend, he's my blood brother. You know, I'll do anything for him. I'd leave in the middle of the sentence if he called me, you know, in need of help. Yeah. And as we're discussing what we're gonna do, that's when I get shot in my left thigh. And the impact of that round knocks me off the mountain we're fighting up. And I fall approximately 45, 50 feet into a ravine, and I break my knee, or I fracture my knee and break my femur in my right leg. Mm. Fracture my hip on my left side, break my nose, you know, some other subsequent injuries, and I'm down in this ravine for approximately an hour.
Did those breaks come as a result of just tumbling down this ravine?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. The actual impact of it, had I not been in full gear, the actual impact of the fall would have killed me, but, you know, luckily I was in full gear and had a large pack on my back that mm-hmm. braced my fall. But I'm down here, and, you know, these are the darkest thoughts of my life. I'm 25, and I'm sitting in a ravine in Afghanistan after being shot and flying off a mountain. I don't have a weapon anymore, it came off my body. I don't have a radio anymore, it mm-hmm. came out as well. Mm-hmm. And I'm down this ravine, and, you know, the people that I've discussed this situation with, they always ask me, is that the time that you truly wish you never would have joined the military? And I can say honestly that thought never crossed my mind. The thought that crossed my mind was, you know, along patriotic lines of, I wish I had another life to give to this country, or I wish there was some way I could get, you know, my broken body back up there to join the fight for those men, because that's my purpose in life, is, you know, to be there for those guys and to support them.
Did you stay conscious?
Yes, sir, unfortunately. A lot of pain, but it gave me a chance to really reflect on my life up until that point in time. When people talk about that near-death experience and, you know, the light at the end of the tunnel and all that kind of stuff, that didn't happen from my experience. For me, it was looking back and being proud of the life that I've lived and the opportunities that, you know, not only this country's given me, but just like this world. I could say I was smiling quite a bit.
Yeah. And so what's next? You're there, you're looking up, I mean, your life is flashing, you know, you're thinking about all that has happened, and then what?
Luckily, my blood brother, Josh, he saw where I flew off the mountain. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, he got shot right after I did. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if we had more time, I'd go into the little back and forth that me and Josh had after he had found me. But, you know, during that time, the conversation me and Josh had that I really would like to bring up is when we looked at each other and we knew that, you know, this could possibly be the last moments that each of us shared on this planet. But at the same time, you know, we could look at each other and say, you know, I love you, brother, and I'm glad that I'm here with you. And if there's no one else on this planet that I could share this moment with, you know, it was just that sense. And for me,
let me ask this question: Josh, black guy, white guy, Hispanic guy?
Josh Medlin is a white guy from Paducah, Kentucky. Mm-hmm.
So white guy from Paducah, Kentucky, and you're from Tennessee.
Yes, sir.
And you're both now down in this ravine.
Absolutely.
Both shot.
And both of you are shot defending this country. And defending a country whose some people still talk about race having relevance.
That, it disappoints me on one level, but at the same time, it excites me because the conversation needs to be had. Mm-hmm. I enjoy engaging people on topics of race, politics, and things of that nature because, number one, you have to have those conversations in order to move forward. Mm-hmm. If you don't, then you're going to stay stagnant where you're at.
My point was, when it really gets down to it, at that moment, I would strongly suspect race didn't matter.
Absolutely not. Race is, you know, in my opinion of race is something you check on an application for a job.
Yeah.
Race isn't something that I'm going to have qualms about when it comes down to me making it back to see my family or not. Mm-hmm. There was never a single thought that crossed my mind that, oh, I wish this was a black or Hispanic guy or
okay.
something like
so
that.
So I do want to know how you got out of there.
Like I said, Josh found me. We galvanized the rest of, you know, the element to remove myself from that hole. Unfortunately, all they had to do was, all they could do was drag me by my legs and get me to the medic. So, you know, they got me to the medic, which he lives in Brooklyn with me as well. So I could see him quite a bit, the man that saved my life, David James. So they did get me to the medic. They did get me some help and got me medevaced out.
Anybody get killed in that mission?
Yes, several people, unfortunately. For me personally, the hardest hit wasn't my personal injury. It was the next day when I got the news that I lost one of my soldiers. It was a 4-day long mission, and day three, Christian Cade Warner had, you know, been shot during an engagement, and he did not make it through. So that was the hardest hit for me. And I would have rather been shot hundreds of times and taken every single bit of his pain just so that didn't happen to him.
That's okay. So I think that's a good place to now discuss how veterans come home and the treatment they get and the treatment they don't get.
For the United States, you know, it's a magnificent country. Sometimes the politics aren't as magnificent as the country is. And I feel that one of the main catalyst that's caused the climate that we live in now with the military and our country and benefits and things of that nature is that the country doesn't go to war with its military anymore. You have situations in which you have conflicts going on in Iraq and Afghanistan, but you don't have anything going on in the country that lets people know, hey, this country's at war. You have servicemen and women deploying thousands of miles away, protecting this country, and we need you to, you know, play your part. There's no war tax. There's no sense of, hey, this is what I need to do in order to support the men and women overseas. What can I do to help? I mean, you look back in our country's history, and you had an overnight change of manufacturing going from cars and things of that nature to bombs and planes and tanks. Mm-hmm. Taxes would go so we could pay for this war. You don't have that anymore. The country doesn't have a vested interest.
So this studio sits just about in the middle between the White House and Capitol Hill. And so I suspect they all watch this show.
Oh, I have no doubt.
So speak to them.
Well, tell them about Fort Gordon to give them context on this.
Fort Gordon is the first stateside military hospital that I went to during my recovery. And I had a horrendous experience there.
Where is it, Fort Gordon?
Fort Gordon, that's in Georgia.
Georgia. Mm-hmm.
It was a horror story. You know, I couldn't put it any other way. The treatment that I received was inadequate. It was under par. It was disappointing. It was obscene. It was a disgrace to the military.
And give us some examples.
I'm being instructed after, you know, an 8 to 12 hour plane ride from Germany with no pain meds. I'm being instructed to fill out paperwork and try to find how many awards I had or my evaluation report from years ago. Before I'm able to be treated, I have to be, you know, in processed. And
first of all, again, for me and for our cherished viewers, you flew from Germany, however long that was, call it 10 hours, without pain medicine after having gotten shot and broken all of these bones?
Correct. There was no one on the plane to administer the medication. So they kept telling me, once you get to the, you know, hospital, that's when they'll take care of you. Yeah. And I get there and they're like, oh, you got to fill out this paperwork. You got to do this. You got to do that. And it's the only portion of my lifetime, in my adult lifetime, that I've ever, you know, shed tears just out of being degraded as a human being. Mm-hmm. And just like, after everything that's happened, very recently.
So there's nobody there greasing the skids for you, handling all of this.
It was an experience that I can truly say ranked above being injured overseas. The pain that I experienced being shot and flying off the mountain and so on and so forth, minuscule in the way that my heart, you know, just like pained as that experience was going on. And I continuously was praying to myself that I'd wake up from this terrible nightmare, and it never happened. Yeah. And it just continued on. And I asked myself, if, you know, I would try to struggle to sleep, you know, this can't be what's going on right now. This can't be reality. This can't be what other soldiers are going through. And that's what my fear turned into, is how many other soldiers are going through this, mm-hmm. but we don't hear about it. That's the scary part. Mm-hmm.
You know, we start the show here by saying that we hope to inspire you with stories of an extraordinary achievement. And I must say that you fit very well in that particular profile. We want to get back to that still, because being that it is Veterans Day, we don't want to take our foot off the gas in terms of enlightening and illuminating our audience to perhaps have them sensitized to the plight that you all endure. We want to get, Mark, to the Warrior Scholar Project. Talk to us and share with us what it is that, if anybody out there is a military family, has someone that might be in the military that has gone into service and come back, how they might be benefited or impacted by the Warrior Scholar Project. What do they have to do?
Well, if you're going to give me free advertising, I'll take it. First of all, you can go to www.warrior-scholar.org and you'll get all the information you need. The idea, Rock, is that it gives, just as Mark and James are telling you about the tools that they were receiving during boot camp, that's what we're giving these folks. We are putting them together so that this is a shared experience, so that nobody's doing this alone. We are keeping them busy all of the time so that the emotional issues that sometimes comes back gets dissipated. It's
keeping them busy doing what?
They are studying. They are learning life experiences back and forth. The curriculum started out. We have de Tocqueville. We have some Greek philosophers. We are helping them focus academically on the issues that they on the ideas that they were fighting for. Mm-hmm. What does freedom mean? What does democracy mean? You know, why do you put your life on the line? These are issues that these are great ideas, and everybody wants to carry the flag, but they never quite understood in school what does it mean. And this is sort of the contextual basis for the program during that the 1 week. At Yale, it's 2 weeks. We're going to put STEM in there also, so that we're helping direct some people into sciences, technology, engineering, and math, so that if that's their inclination. And this is sort of a break 'em, it's not really break 'em down, but it's, you know, you're coming in without confidence, you're coming in without any sense of success in the academic world, and we're letting them know that they have the skill set, they have the ability to succeed.
And
we're at Yale. We started at Yale, and we had the fabulous faculty volunteers at Yale. John Lewis Gaddis, who won the Pulitzer Prize, Professor Kagan, who's also, I think, won the Pulitzer Prize. I mean, these are world-class scholars, and they said, look, we're volunteering our time. We're going to do this. We went from Yale to Harvard to Michigan, to University of Chicago, to Georgetown, to Oklahoma.
And so give me an example. Like, what does a Georgetown do for you?
Georgetown is the host for us. Mm-hmm. And Georgetown, we go to Georgetown and we say, look, we want you to host us. We try to get these schools to give us a good cost package when we go in there. And we get their faculty support. And we bring in somewhere in the neighborhood of 15 to 20 students for that 1 week. Mm-hmm. And some of these students will end up, as in the case of Mark, they end up at Georgetown. Mm-hmm. But many of them, in the case of James here, who was at the University of Chicago, James is at CUNY and Bronx Community College. But if all goes well, next year he's going to be at Columbia. Mm-hmm. Now the thought, and did you say Columbia, Tennessee?
Right? Yes,
the thought that James from Columbia, Tennessee is one day going to get a BA from Columbia University was what?
It's destined.
It was destined now, but I mean, you never would have thought that.
No, absolutely not.
Mark, tell me about your time in the program and what it did for you.
Absolutely. I think this is such an amazing opportunity for student veterans. And there's no denying the heroes like James that come home and don't get the right treatment as veterans, but there are amazing opportunities for veterans, and the post 9/11 GI Bill is one of them. And something, and let me be clear that I only speak for myself and no other veterans, but in my personal case, I sold myself short on what I was capable of. And the Warrior Scholar Project was just one more step in really instilling and revalidating that there is no limit to what we can do as veterans.
And how did it do that?
So I just want to go back again to what we were talking about as far as being pushed to do things that you had no idea you can do. Mm-hmm. Again, I was a 17-year-old kid that couldn't wait to be out of high school and join the Army because I had no interest in higher education. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I hope some of my high school teachers look at this tape and just roll in laughter. It's unimaginable that I'm a student at Georgetown University right now. So as soon as I got in, I called the VA office and I was talking to them about getting the paperwork started because we know it can take some time. Mm-hmm. And I heard about this incredible program. And thankfully, the amazing people at the law firm where I was working, they paid for me to go for the week. And it was just, again, just reinforcing the fact that a motivated veteran can do anything. And you take the things you didn't think you can do, and you take what you excelled at as a soldier, an airman, a marine, a sailor, a paratrooper, and you apply that academically. And I'm telling you, when you have that motivation and you see what a motivated veteran can do, there's no stopping us. And we're learning from people from Yale. You have the chair of the Georgetown English Department teaching you how to write your papers. You get a little stuck and you need a little help, and your tutor is an English graduate from Yale. What more can you ask for in trying to learn how to write a college academic paper? So that 1 week of being able to be at Georgetown, be on the campus, learn from the faculty there. I mean, we had Eric Langenbacher, who is the head of the Georgetown Government Honors Program, talking to us about democracy. And let's also highlight the irony that as kids raising their hand at 17 to defend the Constitution, we don't always even know what that means. Yeah. And now we're learning about it from these incredible, you know, faculty members and people that were ambassadors, you know, for presidents. It's second to none. And by the way, it's free for no cost to the veterans other than getting there. So, yeah. I mean, it's second to none.
James, I really want to come back to you because I think that on this day that we celebrate veterans, that part of being able to fix the problem is to understand the problem.
Absolutely.
And I think that what you were talking about, your experience at Fort Gordon, again, illuminates an issue in a real life kind of way. So I would like to call on, you know, more of your example and of what you experienced to one, highlight the plight and at least be able to identify some of the horrors of the problem. So continue if you would.
I'll slightly shift gears to the mental health aspect because, you know, my experiences overseas, you know, definitely did impact me, you know, substantially. And I do struggle with post-traumatic stress syndrome when it comes to certain portions of those events. So when it comes to identifying some of the problems that we have to address with our military and taking care of them after they come back from overseas, the mental health aspect is one of the largest ones that we neglect. And I'll speak just for myself and tell the typical infantry story of your military life when it comes to psychiatric help or mental health. You don't do it. You don't do it because your dedication is to your brothers and sisters and the uniform and the job and the mission. You don't have time to deal with some of the issues that you should be dealing with before and after deployment. Mm-hmm. And I'm not gonna say it's officially systematic, but it's one of those unsaid things that, you know, you really don't need that help. What you need to do is strap up your boots and go back overseas and fight for your country harder. And you're just not being tough enough. You're hurting, yes, but at the same time, you can still do the job.
There's a certain insanity and vulgarity in it.
Yes. Yeah. And we need to appreciate these men and women that volunteer their lives and volunteer their time, because those are two of the most precious assets that we have, is our lives and our time. Mm-hmm. And these people give it to us. And they say, hey, I'm dedicated to the mission. I'm dedicated to helping out the country. How can I do it? And we don't follow that up with, how can we help you after the fact? We get broken down physically throughout the job, and we accept that. The physical care can be there if you seek it out. Yeah. It's very hard to navigate sometimes, especially once you get out of the military, dealing with the VA system. It's very slow, very, very grinding of some individuals.
Mm-hmm. But I would like for you, because inevitably there are families out there who have veterans who come back, kind of don't understand why some of their behavior may be peculiar. You talk about post-traumatic stress syndrome. Can you share with us so that they might understand how that affects you and what it causes you to do?
For me, there are certain things, and I can never anticipate them, that trigger certain memories to come up. And for me, that is what I struggle with, is someone could say something to me that one of my soldiers said to me while I was in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. And that triggers that memory to come back up. And then with that memory comes along all the feelings and the emotions that I had during that time. And then in the aftermath too. So, you know, all of this emotion starts building up inside of me, and it just overwhelms me sometimes. But at the same time, simultaneously, I'm trying to shield myself from the world by pushing that all down. Yeah. And not letting the world know how much I'm hurting inside. Because as a soldier, as a leader, you know, you didn't have time to do that. You didn't have time to, you know, sit down and say, man, I'm just not feeling it today.
Yeah.
You don't have time for that because your responsibility is so high. You can't stop. And then you have that that moment where you look to the guys to your left and your right and you see they're not stopping and you're like, well, let me keep going. But there has to be a rededication from this country to our men and women that wear that uniform, past, present, and future. Otherwise, you're going to disincentivize people to join, because if they continuously see someone not getting the care that they desperately require, why would I jump into that pool? If there's, you know, one little hiccup in a pool, I'm not going to jump in. So a lot of people see that, you know, we've gotten better since Vietnam, but there's a lot of work to be done. There's a lot of work ahead of us, and we have to get on it. Otherwise, it's going to be one of those situations we're going to wonder why it's a national security situation that we can't get people to voluntarily join our military forces, and we have to bring back and dust off the draft. I think that would be a path that no one wants to walk down. So in order for us not to have to illuminate that path, we have to like deal with the situations that we're dealing with here and now, which is the men and women that aren't getting the care that they require.
I have someone in my ear saying that we had 30 seconds and now it's probably about 25. They've been saying it for a minute or so, but I've learned when to shut up. And you, as a veteran, you represent this country, and I think you represent veterans very well. Mark London, thank you for the work that you do. Mark, thank you so much for joining us here today as we wrap up this celebration of Veterans Day. Thank you all so very much. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you and see you the next time. Take care of our veterans.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.